So we're ready to kick it off here.
All right. Hello and welcome to the Iron Mountain Hour. My name is Cliff.
I'm Tim.
And I'm Dustin.
Hey.
Dustin Whoop.
We are just here in Carter County, Tennessee. It is September the 19th, 2021. It's a Sunday. It's an overcast day. We're having a good time just sitting up here talking and, you know, kind of doing what we do on this podcast, which was talk about whatever it is that we're interested in at the time. And we're going to kind of shoot the breeze about some current events and stuff. But first, I wanted to go over a little something about Carter County. And you probably, if you live in Carter County, if you grew up in this area, or maybe even if you're a fan of history, you've probably heard about the Over Mountain Victory Trail. We all heard about it a lot growing up, but you kind of tune it out as a kid, I guess, because it's kind of boring because it's your area.
Repetitious to the point you forget about it.
Yeah.
You forget the details. You've heard them so much.
Yeah.
So continue.
So, no, it's a good point. We kind of get used to hearing that story and we don't even think about how significant it is. But it was actually a super big turn in the Revolutionary War. And what had happened is the Brits had made a deal with the Cherokee Indians who live over on this side of the Appalachian Mountains that we were going to move back and there wasn't going to be any white settlement past Kingsport, which was called Carter's Valley at the time. And there were some people who lived here who had settled in and they didn't want to be moving anywhere. So they decided to lease their land from the Cherokee and they created settlements here. And they actually ended up creating the first democratic government that was west of the Appalachian Mountains in the U.S. And they called it the Washington District. And they met down in Carter County where the covered bridge is now in Elizabeth. And you can go down there and you can see a stump from the tree that they met under. So these guys were pretty revolutionary in that. It was the first time that had been done. And they were going against the crown when they did this. So meanwhile, this is in the late 1770s. So the revolution is going on right now. And people are picking sides and skirmishes are happening. And there's some guys that live around here who would go on to be famous Tennesseans, Kentuckians, North Carolinians, who were a part of the Patriot cause. And there were some skirmishes going on with some of the British colonels who were in South Carolina and North Carolina. And some guys, Isaac Shelby included, I think John Sevier was also on it. Anyway, they went over and they fought some of the men who were over in North Carolina and ended up getting chased back over the mountains where Patrick Ferguson, who was a major for the British Loyalists, he says to him, he sends word, you know, if you guys don't lay down your arms and swear loyalty to the king, we're going to come over there and take all your weapons and burn the place to the ground and hang your leaders. Now, with the British power being, you know, the mightiest army in the world, you'd think that would be an intimidating threat, but not to the people who lived here. They said, we're going to get you before you can kill us. So they all got together and they mustered here at Sycamore Shoals in Elizabethan, and they all climbed over the mountain through Run Mountain, went through North Carolina, down to Kings Mountain in South Carolina. They captured 500 of Major Patrick Ferguson's men, killed Ferguson, and caused Cornwallis to have to retreat into South Carolina instead of invading Charlotte, which ended up causing Cornwallis to not have the support he needed when he went on to Yorktown, which is where he eventually had to surrender to the Patriots. So if it wasn't for the Over Mountain men, the Revolutionary War might have turned out a whole different way. And I just thought it was really cool about the heritage of this country and the people who used to live here, and a lot of us that are descended from them. And that just spirit of defiance is still alive and strong today. I think it's really important for independence and freedom and for people to have the liberty to live as they so choose. You have to have that defiant nature. You have to have it be through a society enough to where if the authorities want you to do something that is absurd or against your own interests, that you'll stand together and say, hey, no, it's too much. So that's basically why I wanted to talk about it. I thought it was cool. And they do a thing down here in Sycamore Shoals in July called the Liberty Program where they show this story. And, you know, I used to see when they first started, I think it was 2014, they started doing the Gadsden flag tags in Tennessee, and I'd see these, and I'd say, oh, that's real, you know, don't tread on me, but you're paying
the yellow license plate.
Yeah, the yellow don't tread on me license plate. And I'd think, well, you're paying the government to get this license plate, which technically you are, but I got one when I found out where that money goes. It actually goes to the Sycamore Shoals Historic Fund, so that helps them put on the fund. To keep this story going and make sure everybody knows this, to put on those plates, so anytime somebody buys one of those guest and flag tags in Tennessee, that's where the money goes. And I thought that was pretty cool. $60, so if you feel that, you know, if you're proud of that heritage and you think it's really cool what they did here, you know, it's worth the $60 to me to get that. I was glad to do
or
it.
Or you just help. Want to have something that's pre-setting up a heckler. Because you know there's people out there that just want to find those tags. What you doing there, dummy? And then you can be like, actually, knowledge is power, you know, and troll them. Anyway, sorry.
No, I did do it to a guy at work. I did that one on him.
Did you? Well, okay.
But I thought that was pretty cool. And they ended up, those guys, they tried to form the state of Franklin, which ended up failing because they couldn't get any recognition from North Carolina or from the Congress. But John Sevier, he didn't really want to do anything to do with the state of Franklin, right? But everybody that lived here wanted him to be their leader. So he said, well, I guess I kind of have to be their leader. In his private letters, though, he said it was not something he was really in support of, but publicly the people who lived here wanted that from him, so that's what he did. And he ended up fighting very hard for it, having skirmishes with North Carolina, where they were capturing each other's courthouses and going back and forth with the state militia in North Carolina. Eventually, though, John Sevier gets captured, and they finally give up on the state of Franklin. They get Sevier back, but they send a guy to Washington, or he's supposed to go to Washington, but all he does is write Benjamin Franklin and ask for his blessing on the state of Franklin. And Franklin says something to the effect of, I think the state you're talking about is called Frankland, so I wish you luck with whatever it is you're doing down there. So just kind of burned him pretty good. But anyway, John Sevier then goes back to North Carolina after the whole state of Franklin's over. He goes into the state legislature there, and he votes to sell the western land of North Carolina to the federal government, which is what the people who lived here wanted anyway. They wanted to be able to buy that land from the federal government and then create their own state, which they do, and they call it Tennessee, and John Sevier is the first governor. And then Isaac Shelby ends up going on to be the first governor of Kentucky. So those guys kind of helped form the southeastern or the eastern government on the west side of the Appalachian Mountains. And that's why everything around here is named after him.
That's interesting that the... because I'm sure if you look at we don't have our computer set up yet, or the goal is to eventually have some visuals. If you look at the location at the state of Franklin, I guess we don't notice it because we're so used to the location of our state. When you look at that little tip on Tennessee, you know, we're in that tip, like you can take your finger and point in the little right there in that little triangle. But like that's pretty much where the state of Franklin was, in that little triangle. And then for some reason, when Tennessee, which I guess would be state of Franklin 2.0, they went all right this, and then they went and they stretched it all the way as far west as they could. And that's just interesting to me.
Yeah, they took it on to the Mississippi. That was as far as they could go when they formed Tennessee. So that was where they went, right to the edge of it.
Wonder what it'd be like if they could have took more.
Yeah. Oh yeah, they could have had Tennessee states. All the way out to California.
That'd be kind of cool, actually.
That's how we ended up in Tennessee. That's how we ended up in Carter County. It used to be Blount County, North Carolina, and then state of Franklin, then Tennessee. So if you're not from here, that's where we are. And if you are a student of Revolutionary War history or just a student of American history in general, it's a really cool story. Look it up. There's a lot more to learn about it, a lot more details. I don't have time to go over all of it. I don't remember that much more of it than what I just told you. So anyway, I just wanted to spread that around a little bit, get some people talking about it. Speaking of people talking about it, you know, the last week we did a program on smart poles where we talked about how Johnson City is partnering with Bright Ridge and the TVA to install quote-unquote smart poles in downtown Johnson City. Dustin, did you get a chance to check that out? Have you heard anything about that?
I've heard a little bit of it, yeah. That's about it.
Yeah, so what it basically boils down to is they have cameras on them, they have microphones, they have sensors, they can... And we don't know what Johnson City is going to do with theirs, but that's what's available in a smart city infrastructure. They have parking and traffic meters. They also can, I imagine if they have a 360-degree camera, they can run software on that to track who's on the camera. Mm-hmm. You know, facial recognition software could be part of that. And they are selling that data to the TVA. And they're also going to have, more than likely, have Wi-Fi, which if you connect to that Wi-Fi, or even if you just incidentally walk by the pole with your Wi-Fi on, it's going to have a record of your phone connecting to that Wi-Fi. If you then accept their terms, they're probably going to have access to your cookies, any sites that your phone is on while you're walking through there, who you're with, a lot more information than your local government really needs to have, or especially the TVA. What the hell are they going to do with it? Mm. Nobody really knows, and nobody from WJHL really asked the question. Mm-hmm. I haven't been able to get a hold of anybody to ask them that question. I've made some calls, haven't had any return. Maybe somebody else can, if you see this, can give us some answers on that or tell us who we might talk to. But I did notice I had that video set on private, and by the time a couple weeks went around, it was up to like 60 views, even with it set unlisted. So that means the people that we shared it with to kind of get an idea how the pod was going, we're watching it and we're sharing it with other people. Because mm-hmm. I probably shared it with 5 people.
I shared it less than 10.
Okay, so between that, you know, it got shared around, and if I'm not mistaken, YouTube doesn't count duplicate views. So if you watch that video, it's not going to count it if you click it on again, unless you re-watch the whole thing.
That's a hard one to get with. If it's legitimately another person who is just mesmerized by your video, the analytics in your video thing will actually show you how many are unique views versus how many are double reclicks. But you get credit for a reclick on the YouTube algorithm.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay, then I'm mistaken on that.
But I only watched it once to make sure I didn't come across in some way. So I would be one click right there.
Okay.
But even if I had gone back, or even if you tried to watch it yourself like 1,200 times, you're not.
Yeah, if I watched it on mine that I uploaded on our Mountain Hour channel.
No, I don't think you can affect your own view count.
Okay. And if you're seeing this somewhere else, then you can subscribe. Right now we're just on YouTube on the Iron Mountain Hour. If you want to subscribe, that'd be cool. You can send us ideas. We're hoping to eventually build this to something with a lot more audience participation. We can even have a live show, have audience call-ins.
A lot of local news, stuff, that sort of thing. Cliff here is going to spend a lot of time doing journalism and actually sending emails and finding relevant reporting. And I'm going to bring complete BS that took nothing. And that's most of the part I'm worried about, because if I had my way, our 10-year plan would be on BitChute, nothing else, because
we'd be censored. And I do want to move to
for stupidity.
there's a few free speech platforms out there that I'm really big fan of. I mean, you've got BitChute, which I'm not a huge fan of the interface, but I am a huge fan
of
the idea.
There's really nobody on BitChute. That is one of the problems, and one of the issues with BitChute too is if your video is more than like 10 frames a second, it won't upload. It's a really small thing. So it's really good for archiving.
Okay.
But above that, I think like you go to Odyssey.
That's like Odyssey is one that seems to be.
Yeah, and plus we're not really talking about two hot button issues. I'm just being this facetious.
Well, we may though, because I want to talk about whatever we want to, and who knows what may become a hot button issue.
Who knows what in the world is a hot button topic issue?
Yeah, I've got a few things.
6 months from now, this could get flagged for something. Right. You know.
I mean, I've got issues
because goths are illegal or something.
So you never really know what they might go back and change something up on as far as what's socially acceptable. I mean, you'll see people go back and say for saying things that were commonplace in the time they were saying them. People will come back and our values have changed, and they'll say pick out this one person because they've got a record of them having this view when realistically it was the mainstream view at the time. So that kind of stuff happens, and then you do see stuff removed off of YouTube, especially kind of some of the conspiracy stuff we're talking about, even if we're just discussing it. Not that we, you know, we don't believe the Earth is flat, but you never know. They might decide
I'm actually
to start pulling that
stuff
off.
Teetering on the edge of being a flat earther just to annoy everybody.
Yeah. That's fun, though. That's kind of like when I want to put a bunch of people get mad at me, that's all it's for.
It's okay.
No, I want to do the same thing. I want to put a Trump sticker and one of those equality stickers on there on my car.
Oh, like gay for Trump?
Yeah. No.
It's actually quite a few.
Well, not gay for Trump, just the Trump sticker, and then something that seems diametrically opposed
to the
political
sphere.
You want to
really blow their head.
I don't know, Trump and Antifa on top of each other.
There you go.
You know, that way people don't know what the hell to think of.
Like Antifa members for Trump?
Yeah.
We can start it.
Gun owners for, I don't know, name your anti-gun politician.
Wiener?
I'm sure he was.
The dude from Midwest that was running up against Biden. What was his name?
I don't know, but Bloomberg. Buttigieg.
Buttigieg.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah,
he was that anti-gun.
Yeah, a lot of your Democrat guys are, and then a lot of your Republican guys will vote for anti-gun bills and let anti-gun bills pass, and then they'll talk really big about how they're for the Second Amendment, you know. But who knows what of that stuff might come back around and get thrown off. So basically, that's why we'll probably try to move to multiple platforms. DLive is a good one. That's actually, I think, a blockchain-based video platform. There's Peeled.net and Foxhole, which are some lower ones, but you can actually upload high-quality video. You can stream. So as we get going a little bit more, and if we get some people watching this and interested in it, that's kind of where we're going to end up migrating and probably have our own website and stuff, too. Mm-hmm. That way you can find the content no matter where you want to.
And in case you're worried about not being able to find it, one of the advantages to the streaming sites is, if, like, for example, you didn't want to create an Odyssey account, Cliff here can just share our live stream link to his account, and then you just click on it, and you can just watch it from there. There's no real paywall or anything like that. Do we want to move into talking about this nonsense here?
Yeah.
Do you have an interjection?
I did kind of have one thing, you know, with, like, the smart polls. Mm-hmm. Like, how would they said the Wi-Fi you're talking about? I mean, I know it's not a save all end all, but that's why I rock a VPN.
Yeah,
especially on your cell phone.
I've heard a couple of people, which
I mean, it's
I'm not smart at computer stuff, but I've had a couple of people say, in the end, a VPN still can't protect you.
It's not,
and
but
since
it's
the government smart poll, I would think that would be if anybody can hack your phone, it would be them.
It's an extra layer. It's, you know, it's encrypting it to where they don't have this, like, ready. It's not like just laying it out on the table.
Yeah.
They have to be like, you know, look at it.
They would have to want to get in there. They're not just going to collect your data incidentally if you have a VPN, right? They're going to have to say, I want to know who this is.
They're going to have to go through a few extra steps to find out what kind of
especially
porn
it's like,
watching.
Maybe. It's like, especially, it's like whenever you've got it routed and it's your phone's IP is saying you're in another country.
Yeah.
Or just don't walk around in public with your Wi-Fi on. That's big one.
Or make your Wi-Fi, because a lot of phones, mine will, if you don't set it to not do this, it will search for Wi-Fi constantly, even when your Wi-Fi is not on, and it'll turn on and try to connect stuff. Mm-hmm. So the VPN, I think, is good, and then not only that, it lets you do stuff like access content.
The geo-restricted content.
Yeah. So I think it's pretty cool.
So you can actually visit China and jump out of a server into another country and access things that, you know, you couldn't in any
places. I would
like
to point that
really
you can't visit China right now.
Well,
I don't want to get blocked for false information.
I'm just
the guy on the podcast. Go to China. I'm suing you, Delta.
You can digitally visit China with your IP address.
There's actually a few good streaming sites. If we're on the thing, I don't want to go down a China conversation. That's too big. Because I can play both sides of the fence on that in big time. There's some pretty good streamers actually in China that just drive around China, so you can go, oh, okay, I can actually see what China is. It's really funny because I'm like,
well, we don't really know. I mean, usually if you hear about China in the United States, it's some sort of political messaging.
There's
on
a lot
whether China
of,
is great.
I mean,
or
I
bad
think
or
we
whatever.
Should maybe even talk about that on a week all by itself because I think it's too big. But
really?
I really feel like China is kind of like a propped up boogeyman at this point.
Well, their monetary system is trillions of dollars past what is feasible for them to uphold, so they're going to have to make some real moves as far as that goes. We got this idea that because we owe them a lot of money or we have a lot of debt with them that, well, what is our debt based on? It's based on our being able to back up the petrodollar, which that's questionable whether or not we're going to be able to continue to do that. You know, so them even collecting that debt's based on that. But then they've got their own currency problems where they've, you know, trillions of dollars past what they can really handle.
Well, I'll look, here's the way, this will be my capstone on this so we don't go down a super deep China rabbit hole.
True.
I look at the United States, and I'm not familiar, because we can go with any character you want to. Mine is Bob Tilton, who is a TV evangelist. You can go with anyone you want to. The whole point of it is he was a TV evangelist who, in front of America, was clearly ripping people off for $80 million a year or more. And every time they thought they had him, he would just walk straight across the dirty water without getting a speck on him, start right back doing the same thing he was doing, Mm-hmm. Only this time he'd be like, middle finger and get an even bigger house. And crazy stuff like that. And the whole time, there's like an 8-hour long documentary called The Gospel of Greed you should watch if you've got time for it. Just watching this, the whole time you're going, he's going to prison. He never does. He may be dead in the last 5 years, but I found a video from 5 years ago of this man, ancient, still ripping at least 700 people off in views. Nice. Because he never got caught. And I kind of view, that's how I view America. They're never going to stop. Because you just said, the petrodollar's shaky. They'll just change it.
Well, yeah.
Our dollar's now based on new units. What's that? Well, this scientist over here says new units are abundant in America, but nowhere else.
Well, ultimately, the military might is what backs up the petrodollar. Yeah. So as long as the United States have that, it's going to be pretty hard to...
But no, it's like the bad guy that is... they're never going to lose. Mm-hmm. Stop.
Well, you see all these guys get caught, especially in federal government politics, and they get caught doing stuff all the time, and nobody ever really gets in trouble.
Yeah.
I mean, occasionally.
I guess I'm thinking of it from the terms of, like, people thought that, and I'm not even saying I think America is the bad guy that a lot of people make it out to be. I think all governments are, but it's like, with America, they always had this thing where it's like, this scary island called South Korea or Vietnam is going to cause the end of democracy. And then they don't. And then, this tiny little place called Cuba suddenly has nukes. It's going to be there's always this boogeyman that we keep, it's almost like a boogeyman carrot that we just keep swinging. And people get mad at you, but it's really hard to tell people. China's just another carrot. We might go to war with them, but I really doubt it. I think it'd be.
It wouldn't really benefit either one of them.
It doesn't benefit anybody from to start shooting at this point.
No, I think we're in.
I'm poor, so I don't know. Maybe it does.
What do you call it?
We are the poor.
Generation four and fourth and fifth generation warfare, where it's not really, we're not into shooting. I mean, occasionally, yeah, but it's more of economic warfare, computer and cyber and propaganda. Let's try to dominate this country without firing a shot. Let's set them up through entertainment, through all these different media that people consume. Yeah, and let's set them up to be subjugated without having a shot be fired. Do as much of that beforehand, and then maybe you have to fire a shot. But that's kind of what the military was moving towards, even in Desert Storm and Desert Shield. There was a lot of that. A lot of these guys, I think it was like 300,000 Iraqis went and turned in their weapons and laid down their weapons because they were.
Told me about that. He was in Desert Storm and he said, I don't know if he told me this. This was one of the things that happened there. If he said this happened to one of his friends, but he said on multiple occasions he remembered they would be out doing their patrolling and they got lazy at this point because they had just not seen combat.
Yeah.
He said the Iraqis were not engaging them, and so they were out on a patrol one day, kind of half-assing it with their rifles. And he said they all just kind of looked up, and there were a couple of soldiers, and they all had their guns out. They were just done. They were tired of waiting in a dirt hole.
Well,
they wanted to go get water and food, so they just gave up.
Well, and another thing that was happening, this was the first time that this kind of stuff was tried, they were blasting some of these guys with Pantera and Metallica. They were playing this stuff. They were hitting them with radio frequencies that were intended to make them anxious and fearful.
Yeah.
And all these new generational technology that nobody ever used before. And that was one of the reasons we didn't have to fire a shot, because those guys were so on edge and so uneasy, and not only that, they were fighting the biggest military might that the world had ever seen at the time. So there wasn't
silent
a lot of
sound was one of
the yeah that's it
things one of the sound weaponry.
I think it's similar, almost like to when they were dropping those 2 foot long condoms in Vietnam.
Yeah, it was similar to that. Yeah,
like they made the reason that's significant is the Viet Cong were having to travel a good way to get into the United States occupied territory, and what they started doing was flying, like essentially propaganda in the form of condoms. And leaving these apparently used-looking condoms laying around, that way when the soldiers would find it, they'd be like, holy guacamole, these American soldiers have 2-foot-long rods, and they're just robbing our women.
Yeah.
And so they would go home to protect their wives. I don't know if that worked or not, but that's just funny to me that the United States actually spent money dumping condoms. Agent Orange.
Well, and then you had, the kind of thing going with Hanoi Hannah, propagandizing the American GIs, too, trying to say, hey, look, we just, Nobody wants to fight. We all just want to go home. So it was. It's something even been going on for, you know, even since World War II and one, but especially World War II is where that really picked up propaganda with the airwaves, the television, radio airwaves, being able to send that message out across your whole country really quickly and homogenize nations. You had a lot of that going on, and it's kind of even worse now as far as the signal's coming from so many different places. Mm-hmm. It's not just one nation bombarding you. It's not, we're all not all, let's drive American cars, go Detroit, mm-hmm. and, you know, hoorah America, you know, that's still out there, but there's a lot of
loyal now, which is really confusing.
Yeah, it is. There's a lot of corporate propaganda, and well, I don't know if you'd call it propaganda, but just advertising.
I would call it propaganda. Yeah. Have you been to the World of Coke?
Yeah.
I love me some Coke.
Yeah.
And like at the end of it, you get to try like 40 flavors of Coke or something. But when you first get into the museum to take the tour, they put you in a like theater, and they essentially show you this like 4 minute long ad with like Kings of Leon or something playing, where they're trying to loosely show you that your marriage proposal, your kid coming home from World War II or Desert Storm, all these big life events, they kind of would have been sucky if you hadn't had Coke at the same time. It's so absurd,
yeah,
which made me laugh. And then you go inside and it's Coke. But I mean, corporate branding is that just, I know people rage against it, but at this point I actually enjoy it because it's so absurd.
Oh, yeah.
It's like you're the one that fell in love with.
Well, I think nobody's immune to propaganda. But
no, I've got these silly ass posters and stuff behind me. So obviously, here's the Beatles and Kurt Cobain. And Joe, this is all stuff in the conspiracy world that people would say I was a shill for having. And
but if you're aware that you're being propaganda,
yeah, if you're aware of the absurdity of it,
yeah, and some of it's still going to catch you. But at the same time, you can watch the news with a level of not disinterest, but rather than getting all riled up like they want you to about whatever the topic of the week is, you mm-hmm. know, if you sit back and you say, well, let's
objectively discern through all of it.
Yeah, if you know what you're getting into, it's a lot easier to do that.
Yeah. Before we go down a Tim Nave rabbit hole of conspiracies.
Oh, I can't wait.
Because those aren't good. We'll never get out of it. We better go through
it. Dude, that's the most fun part of the show. I mean, we got to have some interesting stuff as far as like...
Well, I'll compromise with you. We'll do ARG robots, because I caught myself.
ARG robots!
I caught myself about to say something that was so absurd. I was like, nope. I could feel people clicking pause on the video as soon as I started to say it. My topic is supposed to be...
Thanks for stopping yourself, by the way.
I'm trying to I don't want to do what I feel like I'll do, which is just take a nice conversation and just go lift. Just smack the hell out of it until we can't get it back. I just want to bring up, we talked about Elon Musk last time?
We did, but, you know, it's been a big week for Elon, so...
I'm hung up on Elon Musk. Yeah. I'm going to have to apologize a little for being hung up on him. My beef with Elon this week, in case Goff wasn't here last podcast. My beef last time was... I think Mars is a little bit of a hoax in the sense that I feel like Elon, even though I don't want to say he's a con artist, I feel like he always builds something up to a 10 and then always offers a 4. You know what I'm saying? I feel like his and almost everything he does could be represented by that. It's not a flamethrower.
That freaking flamethrower is pretty cool, though.
You know what it was?
Yeah, it's like
it's a roofing torch.
Yeah.
So, and it's called not a flamethrower.
It's not a flamethrower.
Because it's not a flamethrower, even though it is a flamethrower. In the same way that he has a green company that's not a green company because it's making a wasteland out of Bolivia right now.
Yeah, oh man.
With lithium batteries.
The cobalt and lithium that are needed for those batteries.
That's what I'm saying. Oh, so man. I think that it's not a flamethrower sums up kind of like his legacy in a nutshell, where it's like, yeah, it's not a flamethrower. It is a flamethrower because you're kind of just selling a shitty product. Like, I don't really know how to explain it.
Did you see that dude stand up on the bus in L.A. there, or maybe it was New York, he was shooting this not a flamethrower? Oh, man, it was pretty cool.
I applaud him.
He was on top of the bus.
And like I said, I don't have as near big of a beef as it's going to come across. I feel like if I just come in here and just be like, yeah, Elon's cut, y'all won't listen to it, so I got to rage against him a little bit.
Well, I mean, he did something pretty cool this week, which was SpaceX put a civilian tourist flight crew in the space for a little bit, and they let it back down yesterday. So that was pretty cool.
Did they go higher than Virgin?
I don't know who went flight higher. I mean, I know space is like officially you can call it space at 80 miles, but really you want to be about 100 to be outside of the atmosphere. Cool. I doubt they were that far out.
I gotta blow your mind.
Well, yeah, tell me.
Oh, we gotta save this one. Here's a pen. Just say, you're at the end, just say, hey, Tim, tell me about the atmosphere.
All right.
This is gonna blow your mind. All right. I'm sorry, this will be this will definitely end it right there.
Okay.
Anyway.
Roll it's always good to have
you
a place
said something.
To go.
Am I interrupting you before I say my beef?
No, go ahead.
This week,
no.
He said AI is the devil, but like last week he said, yeah, but everybody's doing it, so I might as well do it too. You know about this? So Elon's doing AI now, but not just AI. He wants to make fully Will Smith police detective partner automatize people that are going to help us George Jetson style, like pushing buttons, and he wants those things. And that's fine. I totally expect the 1980 whatever Brave New World. I expect it's coming. I can't stop it.
WALL-E.
It's coming. It's all coming. This is when Skynet exists. It's called Google. Yeah, we can't stop it. So that's not my beef. My beef
Blade Runner. Yeah. We're living in the combination of all the dystopian novels and films at once.
It's like a sacred geometry pattern to follow the circles back across.
and the funniest thing is, everybody, if you try to point out the similarities to our life in those stories,
it's because it comes from a movie. That's why we won't listen to it.
What about a novel? That's where a lot of them came from.
But it's still fiction. You know what I'm saying? So just because something, the idea of something is brought up in fiction, people discredit it because there's no way a scientist could have the same idea.
People wouldn't want that happen.
Yeah. There's no way an author and a scientist
the news
the
would
idea.
Tell me.
So anyway, my point, my beef with that is not the fact that Elon is getting it into AI. When he presents the fact that he's going to have robot people, they lift up this veil, whoosh, and there stands an AI person with a blockhead looking thing like a warrior off of Gears of War 5.
Yeah, he's going to have a screen face.
And he's got like the black and white spandex suit on. And all of a sudden, it starts breakdancing poorly, mind you, because it's just a person in a spandex suit, because that's what Elon always does.
And they didn't even get a guy that could dance.
And they didn't even get a guy that could dance, man. Why didn't they get, like, somebody from Dancing with the Stars to start, like, popping and locking to, like, really at least do it good? It was a shitty dancer. And I feel like that's what he always does. Like, well, except for the time the rockets landed themselves.
Now, the rockets
that's pretty amazing
bad.
If it wasn't CGI.
But, you know, with the car in the space now... I'm not saying that they faked that, but I did watch a video, and I didn't go into researching. Was
that's
this
the first
a fake
step
video?
Of being a flat earther, by the way.
the first step would have been to go down the rabbit hole of, did he really fake this shit? But no, what he did was shot that car into space. While you're watching the video, you can see it glitches out, and you can see the hangar. It looks like inside of an aircraft hangar, where this thing is supposed to be. And... you know, somebody may have made that, faked that, and just put it up there. So, you know, I don't know. I didn't look at it any further than that. But it does make you wonder, because it kind of goes with what you were saying, is there's a lot to the show, and then when it comes time to actually put up or shut up, it's kind of like, meh, you know. Except for the rocket tech, which, you know, we've talked about. That's pretty cool.
I just feel like he's faking it to make it. You know what I'm saying? Like, he promises huge, then offers 40% of that, but it's still amazing enough that people keep promising.
I mean, look at the
more.
Tesla, though.
And it's got to keep working.
Tesla
because...
vehicles, if you're not looking, I mean, if you're looking to save the planet, I think there's other ways to look. But...
a lot better fuel sources, especially an EV type. There's a lot better battery technology that's coming out.
But if you want a quick freaking car, those Teslas are like...
And I'm not even saying that, like, I have an issue with that, because I'm not even approaching it from an environmentalist standpoint where I say he shouldn't be... I don't like it when people say this is this and it ends up... like, it's not as environmentally friendly as they're saying it is. I always feel it's like...
nothing is, usually.
Yeah, and it's because green stands for money. It doesn't stand for... Yeah. It's kind of like my issue with, like, veganism. I don't have a problem with veganism. My issue with veganism is one of their big selling points is we're saving the environment. And they're not. They're actually one of the ones that are... they're solely, at this point, one of the sole reasons the rainforest is being destroyed. Because it's being burned down for tofu.
Well, let me give you a quick example
of that stuff.
When people... I saw a whole thread, this was from a farmer, and somebody had mentioned... this was somebody who was a vegetarian. They were saying, why are you eating all those cows? Think of all the resources you're consuming to eat all those cows. And then the farmer broke it down to him. No, actually, your food that you like to enjoy... has, takes this much water, and cows take this much water. This takes this much food, so we have to grow all this. And these cows can just go out in the field and eat, mm-hmm. and we have to give them this much water and this much corn.
Well,
so
it's
they use, they use too, less, yeah. they use less land, they use less resources mm-hmm. to raise all those cows than they do just to do the equal amount of food for that was would be a vegetable or something a vegan mm-hmm. Or somebody like that would eat. So I don't care if you eat like that either, but let's not get all self-righteous about
our choices.
I actually
like the idea of veganism. It's just, I do the math in my head and I realize, well, other than these big vampire fangs that I've got in my mouth too, it doesn't work because, like you was talking about with the cow eating the grass, there's a chemical conversion there because I can't go out there and eat grass.
Right, that's the point, yeah.
But the cow that cow gets big and fat, and now as humans can now turn something that was pretty much we go out there and just mow grass like it's nothing because it's just a nuisance.
Yeah.
And that's food for a creature that we can now eat.
It's also a point of class.
And I look at that, and I go, well, maybe I'm the dummy because maybe I shouldn't be a vegan because I've been a vegetarian multiple times, and every single time I've done it, I felt horrible. Like, weak. That sort of thing. So maybe I'm just not doing it right, but go. Sorry. I'm really go. I'm hearing still interrupted him. I try to be mindful of not doing that.
Oh no, man. I mean, we're just talking here, so I mean I was just talking about how we're just pretending that all these things are good for things.
Okay.
Let's not grandstand by our choices of, okay, I want to eat this way, or I want to drive this cool car, mm-hmm. or I want to do this, and try to make ourselves into a hero because we're doing it. That crap really irritates me. Like, if you want to be a hero, then go out and do something heroic, or go out and do something that helps.
Real heroic.
Actually,
it's quiet.
Yeah, you don't save the planet by buying a Tesla. You save the planet by, you go out and you plant some trees, you pick up some trash, or you maybe even, you can maybe even use your local government or your local, you know, news to expose somebody dumping or get somebody to stop doing something. Hey, that's all great. You know, that's how you save the planet mm-hmm. with actual action, not by, you know, by
Facebook badges are important too.
Yeah. We've got to remember the Facebook pages. Profile pictures. And you know what? While we're talking about it, I'm just going to go ahead and say this. I don't really do social media. So if I had social media, I would probably post. I don't know who needs to hear this, but cigarette butts are trash.
Yes.
If you throw a cigarette butt out in the friggin' road, that's trash. It's disgusting. It's terrible for the environment. So if you care about the environment, throw your cigarette butts in the trash. Put them
your
out for us so you don't burn.
Single-use e-cigarettes and vape pens, those things are worse for the environment than, like, cigarette butts because you have batteries in them.
Yeah.
They're getting tossed out. Mm-hmm. There's plastic and batteries that, you know, aren't probably lithium batteries. They're still probably mercury cadmium and stuff like that. Or nickel cadmium.
Power. Yeah. The more you know. I saw this, it's like burned into my head, and I'm sure they got you all guys too. Do you remember going to the arcade and seeing that, what was it, William S. Thompson's or something like that, and then it said, winners don't do drugs?
Yeah.
It's on every single video game system in America had that on there, and it's burned into my head the way it's burned into those arcade screens to this day.
Yeah. I remember NARC especially, and Operation Wolf.
Winners don't do drugs.
Yeah. The Captain America down at the laundromat. You remember Captain America and the Avengers? And I don't think Ninja Turtles did. But.
No. We can skip right here if you want to. Or unless you want me to.
Well, I did want to talk a little bit about that because the AI is supposed to be part of that robot. And, you know, what are we looking at as far as time here? We're about 40 minutes
in. We got to go off here, so if we run over, it's not a big deal.
Yeah, and we got some time to hit all this stuff. Because I wanted to, while we were talking about AI, because you were talking about Elon getting into AI, and that's mm-hmm. how we got off on the Elon rabbit hole, which is cool. I always love to talk about Elon because he's always at least talking about doing cool stuff, or he's influencing things.
He's involved in a lot. Yeah.
I kind of like watching it, and I applaud him sometimes, and other times I roll my eyes at him and cringe a little bit. But it's definitely fun to watch. And one of the things he was talking about, this AI robot that you were talking about, the Tesla bot, I think he's calling it.
Mm-hmm.
This thing is supposed to be 125 pounds, mm-hmm. 5'8". I looked it up a little bit more after we were talking about it last time because I didn't know enough. But this thing can pick up 85 pounds. And if that's the case, if you have an AI robot that can lift 85 pounds repeatedly, I mean, who knows how long it would actually last, but think about this from you as an investment standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
you could run a factory, you could buy you a handful of these robots, and you could have three workers that, you know, all they have to do is charge. They're you know, whether it's a factory or a warehouse or whatever.
Warehouse is where you definitely
move and lift stuff, and so it could end up being like an opportunity, depending on how affordable these are, for people with less means to be able to
multiply. Amazon won't wear that.
Yeah, well, Amazon and Elon don't always get along. But it could be a way for the small man to really take back some of this stuff, because you just got to pay the robot one time, and then you pay the maintenance mm-hmm. and the charge on it. So that could let somebody who can't afford, you're just starting out, you can't afford a hire help, but you need somebody to bring in your deliveries and keep stuff running, you know, and you buy mm-hmm. the robot one time. Mm-hmm. So you could say that it puts people out of jobs, and people do say that, but at the same time, it kind of allows you, even if you wanted to have the robot to work in your place, like if you had a manual labor job, what if you just sent your robot to work that day?
I'm sending
that
my would body free you today. Up. Just your face on the TV screen. Yeah.
That would free questions. You up for other endeavors, other activities.
You know, also the thing that's taking people's jobs, that's every form of technology that comes out, you know, steam engines, you know, the horse, cars.
Yeah. I'm glad you put the SE on the end of that. I was like, when was that automatized?
Well, you know, there's Japan. I'm sure they're doing something like that. And last time when you and I were talking about this, we were talking about there were servers in Japan. There are electronic servers. Well, they're unveiling those in. I just saw a story about that from last month in Los Angeles. You know, the pandemic in Los Angeles. They are, you know, they're requiring masks of their servers. You know, it's hard to work in a restaurant anyway, in a hot kitchen. Mm-hmm. But if you have to wear a mask all day, that makes it really tough for you. And a lot of times to be in that hot, muggy kitchen and be breathing your own breaths every time. And I'm not even talking about the efficacy of masks or anything like that. I'm just talking about
that's an
added stress to that job. And if you are able to not do that, if you're able to, like, not pay rent or, you know, not, and still get an unemployment mm-hmm. check. And I'm not saying whether or not we should be even doing that stuff, but that the fact is that makes it less likely for you to come to work. So these restaurants in LA in particular were having a really hard time finding people to work. And so some of them started hiring robots, and the people really like them. And there's a little tray. And it goes, it comes and it stands and waits, and then you load the food up on it, and it takes the food right out to the table and gets the food out so the server that is there can be doing other things and mm-hmm. doesn't have to be running food all the time. So she's still got her job. They can't find anybody to work, so it seems like a win-win to me, because the people who want to work are still getting to work. It's not like they fired the mm-hmm. server because they hired this robot. So like Dustin said, it can end up being a supplement to, compliment of
it. I guess the way my mind is jumping ahead, that Yang has already brought the concept of UBI into the arena of politics at this point too. And if you've, and I mean, I'm not saying it's going to get to this point, but every sort of concept that comes up comes out on some level. I know that sounds stupid, but even if you consider like Mad Max and stuff, that doesn't exist, but we still had Burning Man because we wanted it to so badly. So with the concept of UBI and all this stuff, there's a lot of people that we're not going to get to work. Like Japan had a real big problem with this at one point in time, and I don't know the year, it could be now, where they've gone to meets. Was it not in something something something, but it stood for essentially you're sitting at home not doing anything because you don't have to. And we've got a lot of people doing that, but it's almost like they're LARPing. They're pretending like they're doing stuff to hide the fact that they're really just not doing anything in life. They're just staying in one place.
Yeah.
And I think that's going to unravel and come to the surface. Well, see, in the next couple of years.
Well, I think this. I think these robots. I mean, if they really turn out to be what he's selling them as, it could be something of more of a free market, universal basic income. Because rather than you're not getting this money from the government, you're buying a robot that you're sending out to work for you. It's bringing in you a constant stream of revenue. Mm-hmm. So you're basically getting your own universal basic income by your own action, and, mm-hmm. and you're using that to be more productive. So you could have another job if you wanted to. Mm-hmm. If you wanted to be a musician, but you needed a certain amount of income to be able to come
so
in.
So you're saying the robots are passive income.
Yeah, they're basically, investment. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so you could use them as passive income. You could use them to stand in for you. You could use them to start a business in a way, maybe you had a warehouse that was like super hot. You don't can't afford to put air conditioning in it, but it's like 150 degrees in there. So you
well, now you're in Blade Runner.
So yeah.
Well, it's the Undesirables. Because you've got several movies that you could reference though if you really wanted to go into weird rabbit holes. Like Blade Runner would be the that situation where we've got humanoids out there doing space mining and all kinds of stuff, yeah. Just because we don't want to do that to humans.
Or we could do, you know, like Brave New World and just breed test tube babies that are super, they thrive mm-hmm. in the heat.
Yeah.
No, I definitely do not advocate for that. But I think robots...
ideas.
I mean...
was it Runaway with Gene Simmons? Did you ever see it back in the 80s? It's Gene Simmons and Kurt... I want to say Burt Reynolds. Mustache one. That one. And it's a movie about which exactly what you're talking about, where people and the you have to excuse the awful effects because it is like 82.
Oh, I love them.
So they're using like real effects.
I love them.
So essentially, if you want to see Gene Simmons be a bad guy, it's a, there you go. Go watch the Runaway.
Runaway.
Runaway. Gene Simmons. Anyway, the concept of it is there's a police force that is in every police unit now that is just for runaway robots because they're so common in society.
Oh,
now.
Yeah, I do remember that movie.
Yeah, like, so you'll have, like, a kid, like, the movie starts out with him having to take a trainee unit, like a new police officer, to a house where a kitchen bot, for some reason, has started killing people by throwing, like, sharp objects at him and stuff.
Hmm.
So, but anyway, I don't know where I was going with that one. One of my issues with AI is it seems a lot of the people in it are hucksters.
Oh, yeah.
And, like, I wanted to bring up, I don't remember his name
Sophia.
Now.
Sophia.
You know anything about synchronicity there, Mr. Goff?
Singularity.
Singularity, my bad.
I was like...
Synchronicity is a bank, and synchronicity is the smart pole place, right?
Yeah.
And we'll come back to that. Singularity is an AI company that talked them way into even getting on the Joe Rogan podcast, right? They're based out, I want to say they're based out, they're in China, on the island part. And,
Hong Kong,
yeah. If you start tracing the history of these people, though, the guys that are in charge of this, they're shady grifter people.
Was his name Ben Goertzel?
Ben Goertzel, yeah. And I'm not wanting to say it like in a slanderous way. It just seems like they have like a really shady past, and I don't want to go over all of it other than the fact that Singularity was the one that had the bot that became Iran's first citizen. Remember that?
Yeah.
Okay. What you're talking about.
That robot right was just a chatbot. It was not an AI.
Yeah.
Just a chatbot. You can look it up. It's just a chatbot. So anyway, we'll take that they passed a chatbot off as a legitimate AI. That's a grifter, okay? If you go back to when they were in college, they were such big fanboys of this local conspiracy theorist who was actually a legit schizophrenic that they found him at the nursing home that he was dying in and pretend to be FBI agents so they could scare the hell out of him.
Hmm.
Because they thought that would give him some kind of enjoyment, knowing that his conspiracies are real and something. So it's just like, you look at a pattern of a person's behavior over their entire life, and you're like, dude, I don't think you're getting better. Like, it's okay for you to have a redemption story where you get better at some point. I mean, we're all not Christ, you know what I'm saying? But I'm looking at you, and it's like, you still seem like the guy that's staring the old dude in the nursing home when you're passing off Sophia or whatever it is as Iran's first robot citizen.
Yeah, I wonder what it was that... I mean, I wonder why Iran decided to have a robot
citizen. They didn't know any better.
Don't they even, like... Aren't they pretty restrictive about even female citizenship? I mean...
Yeah, they're lower than a house cat over there.
Yeah, so...
Yeah.
So somehow this AI is greater than a woman who, you know, carries their children.
I think it's like a weird flex, honestly. I think it's just strange. Like, we'd be the first ones, you know.
Yeah, it could be, yeah. It could be. Like, Iran is ahead of the game, and that may be what it is. I don't really know. But the whole Singularity project, as you were telling me, aren't there some signs that it may not even be AI to begin with also? Or is it...
Singularity itself, the issue I have with knocking Singularity too badly is because, full circle, it's blockchain. So hypothetically, if people actually just got a hold of whatever the thing they're doing, they could take it from there. I guess we'd have to ask Drew or whatever.
Yeah. Oh, and we're coming up. We're going to do an episode on blockchain and cryptocurrency. So we got a guy who knows a lot about that. He's going to be coming on and talking about it. So if you're interested, be sure and subscribe because that'll be a cool chat.
Who's the other guy that you're doing with the nature stuff?
We got Denzel Pratt, the Mandora Explorer. He is a trained zoologist and he's into herpetology. He's got a really cool YouTube channel called Mandora Explorer. Check him out. He goes out and finds snakes and fish and lizards, and he tells y'all about it. So we're going to come on, have him. He's actually from the Bahamas, but he's lived in this area for a while. He's learned all our animals. He goes out and makes videos of him finding them, telling us all about them, rattlesnakes, you know, whatever it is. You know, I've lived here my whole life, and he corrected me on a rattlesnake thing the other day. So
our own Steve Irwin.
Yeah, that's right. And he's a really cool dude. He's really fun to talk to. We've also got Moose Roberts, local musician, local legend, coming on. There should be a statue of Moose in Bristol.
We can make it happen if we can just get the podcast big enough. We can make that our good deed to Bristol.
I'm serious about that. Nobody makes more music than Moose. And I mean, there may be like famous, you know, I don't know, Mick Jagger may have a bigger catalog than Moose because he's been doing a lot for 50 years. But Moose has over 50 albums. I've recorded an album with Moose. It's an amazing experience. You go in and you sit down, you don't know where the hell they are, what the hell you're doing. Moose says, play these chords real quick. You play a little bit, you doodle a little bit. Next thing you know, you're done. And then you forget what you've played. And then here comes the album, and it's amazing. And so Moose will be on to talk about local music. He'll be here to talk about music stories. Moose has a show on Radio Bristol called Transmissions Under the Wire. It's amazing. I check it out every Wednesday at 6.
Mm-hmm. That's cool. I didn't know about that.
But yeah, so they'll be on.
Pretty cool show.
So we're going to get into all these different topics. And that was basically back to crypto and blockchain that we were going to talk on. So I didn't want to get us too far off topic, I did want to throw in, you know, some of those guests we had lined
up. I said that. I
remember
that. Which one? Singularity. It's a blockchain company, so it's not like... I don't have an issue necessarily. It's even like with like SpaceX and Tesla and all these different companies. I don't have necessarily a problem with the company itself. I don't like... I have issues with people who reveal themselves to kind of be not... That's the sound of a wiener rampage. I don't like people who present themselves one way and are actually another. And when you have a history of grifty behavior, I don't like it when people get in really important positions. It just seems like a very problematic position.
Agreed.
That is all I'm saying. I hope Elon. I hope Elon doesn't ever find out that I have beef with him because I don't. But I actually would think Mac Gertzel or whatever his name is would actually be the more grifty one to get it.
Yeah.
Because he has shit.
He's probably going to come and like contact us to be on the podcast or something. I'm like really screwed with this hardcore now.
That's fine. I'll come on there and make a complete fool of myself for views.
Oh, yeah.
I'm from Carter County. I have nothing to prove.
And again, we're just talking about what we're into and what we think is whatever. So we're not claiming to be experts. We're just guys who sit around and talk. We all like to read the news. We all like to keep up with current events. We all like to laugh at it, the absurdity of the world, and talk about it. So we kind of figured we'd put it on for other people to have this conversation with us. And it's not really happening locally. Like, it's about the smart polls. I think in the same amount of time that we had 60 views on an unlisted video, they had like 400 on their YouTube video. Yeah. So. There people aren't hearing that story from them. Everybody that I've talked to about smart polls, the first person they heard about it was from me. Mm-hmm.
I didn't know anything about it.
And I talked to people.
Never heard anything until you actually sent me that video. Yeah. And it's just like,
and I talk to people who watch the news like regularly. The people I know watch the news, and nobody had heard about it. I hadn't heard about it. B just happened to come across it in her YouTube feed and shared it with me, and we were like, holy crap. There's just a few cities in America that are doing it. Not very many. Los Angeles was one of the first ones they mentioned in the WHJHL report. But European cities and Asian cities are more prominent there. But when we were talking about the old singularity, we couldn't remember the name of them. So we had a little dose of synchronicity because we thought the name was synchronicity.
We also thought it was synchrony too, which ended up being a bank. Credit card.
Yeah. So we ended up looking up synchronicity, and we found synchronicity.
Happenstance.
And guess what they do? They do support infrastructure for smart cities, including smart poles, smart sensors, smart electric grids, smart homes, Internet of Things, and they tie all this together. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we just happened across it, and, you know, who's doing the one in Johnson City? We don't know. We know Bright Ridge is doing it. We know TVA is doing it. We know Johnson City is doing it. We know we're going to be pointing cameras all over downtown, probably in your home if you live down there, in your business. They're going to be listening to you with a microphone. The city of Johnson City is going to gather that data. Who knows what they're going to do with it other than that they're going to sell it to TVA. And their aim is to prevent crime, they say. Just to recap what we went over last time real quick, because we're getting towards the end of the pod here and kind of wanted to tie this all back together. because these nerds are going to freaking kill us, guys. They're taking over. The synchronous cities, the smart cities are popping up everywhere, and they're taking a lot more interest in us than people are taking interest in them. And I think we should have a lot more interest in the people who are taking interest in us and our data, our information. They want to know who. Oh, I cut Dustin's head off.
No.
Let's finish it up here. Yeah, so I don't know where we got cut off exactly. So what I was getting at is, these guys want to know what we're doing, where we're going. They say it's to prevent crime, but they're watching everybody, and they're taking information on everybody. They're selling it to the TVA. That's not cool in my book. Mm-hmm. I don't want to tell you how to think, but why does somebody need that much information on you to be able to control the traffic patterns? I mean, to help with parking. I mean, sit a guy down there and let him watch the traffic for the week, you know, and say, hey, we get a lot of traffic this time and this time.
That was my beef with the smart poles. That's the air conditioner. We'll turn it off next time.
No, man, it's already.
My issue wasn't necessarily the smart poles. My issue is the motive itself. Like, they're like, hey, we're putting these poles in to make these homeless people stop committing so much crime. It's like you're going to put cameras on people and make them stop doing what? Panhandling? There's like, it doesn't make any sense. And so when you give a BS reason for something, automatically you just think you're up to something.
Well, talked about in the last pod, they even, the week before that, or the month before that, they had a city council or a meeting with the community leaders where they even talked about how the homeless aren't really the ones doing this crime. What they have a problem with is, like, people coming down there and sitting in cars and doing drugs and committing loot acts in public and stuff. No, but it was still, it feels like it's more aimed at the homeless, even though the business owners down there are saying, no, these homeless guys aren't really a problem. Mm-hmm. It's the people come down here and doing drugs and doing nasty stuff in public. So that's what we have a problem with. And, okay, so you got police right there. I mean, you were literally, if you jogged to the police station, you could be there in less than 2 minutes. Mm-hmm. So they're right there. What does the smart pole do? It collects data. That's the purpose of it. It's mm-hmm. not to help. I mean, if you need a cop, you can call a cop.
Yeah.
Is it really going to shut down or squish the time for the cop to get there that much?
I don't think so.
And at any prime time where there could be something go down, there's always cops down there. Like,
yeah. Yeah, all of us have been playing downtown Johnson City since we were right out of high school. Never been a night where you've been sitting out there and you don't see a cop drive by every like 5 minutes just to be monitoring. Because downtown Johnson City is a loop. It's not really that big anyway.
No.
Like, Johnson City's been spreading out a whole lot over the years, but downtown Johnson City is, you know, it's that four little pattern, and which I guess is why you only need 2 smart poles. You need to figure out where they're going to be. Just out of curiosity. I'd like to know where they're at.
Yeah, I'd like to get somebody to get back with me on that. I'd have to reach out again. It's been a while since I did. But, yeah, so that's what's been going on in our area over a little while. And then there's the obvious, I kind of feel like we're, what's it called, ignoring the 800-pound gorilla with the COVID things that are coming down and some of the restrictions with that. And I don't want to do that, but I also don't want that to really be the main focus of our talks either for right now, because everybody else is talking about that.
I think everybody is like burned out on COVID. So if we do talk about COVID stuff, I would like to talk about angles that people aren't talking
about. Exactly. So I want to skip that for now, even though I will say, you know, that I do find that
I could tell to capstone it off that way if anybody had, because I will want to talk about this first, and then I can talk about that as a capstone. So if anybody's like, I don't want to hear about COVID, you could just turn it off right there, and then I'm not triggered you and made you mad. But I promise it's not I'm not even going to take a side.
I just want to say mandating a medical treatment is tyrannical. And that's my opinion. You don't have to agree with it. But so that way I'm not a fence sitter. That way I'm not being milquetoast.
Oh, I'm going to sit on that fence so hard.
So I just want to put my feelings out there.
My butt is in a fence post imprints.
If you disagree, if you vehemently disagree, if you're vehemently on the other side of that fence, you know, comment below. DM us, you know, whatever. Because that's what we want to do. When we were talking about even starting this show, we want to have conversations again, right? So maybe I shouldn't phrase it as, you know, it's tyrannical. Maybe I should say...
you can use that word if you can define it correctly.
Well, I think so too. But I think that also makes the conversation harder to have with somebody who falls on the other side of that issue. So I guess maybe if my reason is to have a conversation, maybe even though that's the way I feel about it, maybe I should just say I'm against it rather than saying that it's tyrannical. But yeah. I'm against it. I think it's anti-liberty, and if you disagree with it, that's cool. But the problem is, if you disagree with it, then you're kind of using your, if you use the government to impose it on me, then you're kind of proving my point.
Well, I think one of the issues you're going to run into there is a lot of people are unapologetically authoritarian.
Yeah.
So you can't really argue with somebody like that. It's like, I remember back when I was real hardcore into like the church and stuff, I remember thinking what a waste of time it was for the church to send us out door to door to argue with people about the Bible when they didn't believe in the Bible.
Right.
It didn't make any, like... It's like going up to somebody and saying, hey, would you like to have an argument? And them say, sure. And you say, well, here are my rules. And them say, well, I'm not going to abide by those rules. You can't have an argument. And so I really think that's a lot of what's going on with today. I think a lot of people just need to recognize some people are looking to argue in the sense that I want to scream at you.
Yeah.
And if you come across somebody like that, you just need not to waste your time with it. You're making your own reality more hostile than it needs to be. Do you want to move into this one, or do you want me to go ahead and
go ahead.
What I've got is COVID related.
Okay, well, I just wanted to put that out there, so if you want to put it on there, you can. I didn't want to do a whole show about that because everybody else is. But also, it's a big thing happening right now that just came down with the federal vaccine mandate. It is going to keep coming. So I'm going on the record right now to say I'm against that. If you want to talk about that, we can do a show where we talk about that. But Tim, you go ahead and finish out where you were.
I want to sit on this fence so hard right now. My issue is, when is the last time you've insulted someone into believing what you believe? And Pepperidge Farm remembers never, because it just doesn't happen. You can't insult someone into believing something other than what they believe. What they'll do is they're going to double down, and now you've become like the avatar for things that they're mad about, so you've given them a face and psychology and yada. But my point with, I saw somebody post today, and I'm not going to mention him because he's a good guy, and he didn't mean any offense by it, and I didn't take any offense by it. He said, was there just as much outrage when the polio vaccine was mandated? But yeah, that's exactly what he said. Was there this much outrage when the polio vaccine was mandated? And I can actually discuss this without even being political about it, and the answer is yes. There was. And I can explain why, and it has nothing to do with government, or it does have anything to do with government. It has nothing to do with the topic of liberty and forced vaccinations. The reason people had a problem with it is because polio was first discovered in 1868, if I'm wanting to say, and it was in Europe, and it didn't get bad in the United States until the 50s. The vaccine was first introduced in 55, and people didn't have a problem with it. What they had a problem with was before 55, Big Chemical had found out that DDT would take care of all the pesky insects that they were blaming for spreading the polio. Mm-hmm. And they said, well, hell, it's so effective at killing insects, let's just start spraying school children with it. And they did, and there's videos you can find online now on film archives. You can just go, and they've got all these school children lined up with this little music and stuff, like it's Looney Tunes. They're spraying DDT, and these kids having a laugh.
You can see videos of them chasing the mosquito trucks down the road in
the box. And they're just DDT, it's a one shot and done.
Yeah.
And it turns out that DDT poisoning looks like polio. It actually looks exactly like polio. And so a lot of common farmer folk with no internet started going, well, the government keeps effing with us, so we don't think polio's real. We think DDT is causing polio. And that's where the beginning of your conspiracy on that one is, whether polio exists or not. I just wish people would stop looking at each side and saying, I believe this, so I'm going to stand in my ideological corner, and I'm going to scream at you because I don't like what you're saying because it could be true.
Right. I'm willing to be wrong on this, but I think a big difference between COVID and polio, for example, is with COVID, yes, I mean, everybody knows, everybody unfortunately probably knows someone who has died with or of COVID. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is a real thing. But at the same time, people were seeing many people that they knew be affected by polio when mm-hmm. when it would happen. So there was probably a lot less aversion to the vaccine when, you know, you saw not just one person that you knew mm-hmm. maybe, but, you know, a whole neighborhood of kids down the road were getting in it, and it was, yeah, you were looking out for it. And then also, I'll stop it there, but I just feel like it was something that was a lot more, you didn't need the news to tell you that it was a problem.
But you see the conflation there, right?
Yeah, like, yeah, I do.
The farmers start using DDT, their kids get polio, and then they find out later on that polio is DDT. So, I mean, like, I'm sitting on that fence so comfortably. That's what I want you to know. And the reason I'm sitting on that fence is because I feel like nobody else is. I feel like people are taking sides, and at some point somebody's going to have to stand up on top of it and look down and go, you're right about this, you're right about this. And right now what I'm trying to tell the people who are pro-vaccine is you might want to stop being mean to people, because that's not a way to change their mind.
Yeah.
And what I'd like to say to the anti-vaccinated people is, you might want to stop being mean to people, because you can't change your mind. That's it.
Yeah, yeah. And another thing is, you see a lot of anti-vaccine people, they tell a lot of stuff that they don't have any idea about, like, you know, say, really, really making this thing out to be, you know, deadly and dangerous, and it may be, but they can't back that up, and they're trying to convince you that it is the worst thing that you could take, when, you know, they just don't really have evidence for that. Now, there are reports of a lot of things, but the fact is, a lot of the people sharing it don't really have any conclusive proof of anything that they're sharing, mm-hmm. but they're acting as if they do. And then so they've convinced themselves, and they're just trying to do what they think is right. And then mm-hmm. the same thing with the people who are pro-vaccine. They've convinced themselves, and they've been convinced that that's the right way. So everybody's just trying to do what they think is best. We just disagree on what it is. But that's kind of why we want to have conversations, mm-hmm. is because even if we don't agree, we still have to live with one another. We still have to live in a society with one another. And there has to be discussion for that to happen. We can't just all stand on our separate sides of the fence and mm-hmm. yell at each other to where the point where we're eventually throwing Molotov cocktails at each other.
Sounds funny. The words, at least that
It would be exciting, but I think we had enough of that last year, at least for me.
I didn't get to throw not one.
I missed out too, but I never like seeing violence in the streets. It's just awful, no matter who's doing it or what it's over. But anyway, I just wanted to touch that real quick before we finished off here, because it was just such a big thing in the news, and I didn't want to just not talk about it and be disingenuous by not putting my feelings out there. So anyway, moving on to the atmosphere.
All right. I'm trying to figure out a way to approach this. And one way, I kind of just want to go, sorry to make a Tropic Thunder reference. You can't do that.
No, you can make that movie now, could you?
Maybe I should just go full conspiracy theorist on this and explain where this thing comes from and why. This is how conspiracy theories are made. Did you know the atmosphere technically goes past our moon?
What's it called?
Excuse me. It's just the atmosphere. Like, there's like different layers.
The moon's
of
250,000 miles away, so we still have layers of gas in our orbit.
Because it's not like a defined point where there's a shield that goes, nope, gravity stops here.
Right.
So there's always going to be gas dispersing a little bit, right? So the reason I came across that was looking at, I don't remember what it was. It was a legitimate science thing, like a National Geographic or something that's talking about, did you know our atmosphere doesn't have a point, you know? There's the reason kind of spaceships can't, yeah, it just like keeps hazing out like you would see clouds do. It just gets thinner and thinner until there's a point where it's no longer noticeable. And it was technically the Earth is in our atmosphere, was the video, I think. And the rabbit hole that led me there was, there's a belief that most people in the conspiracy world tend to take the whole pill. Where I like to just like swish it around my mouth. And
we didn't go to the moon.
Oh no, this is even better. All the mountains are actually giant biblical trees, right? Like, so.
That's a new one on me.
Right, I'll show you.
I'm staying with you.
I'll show you. There's no such, like, the way it asked with me is I saw a geologist saying, yeah, everybody likes to say geologists have a trick when they say a geologist doesn't believe in sand. It's just really small rocks. But another mind F I'd like to give you is everything to a geologist is just not a rock yet. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, where'd the rock come from if everything at some point was kind of alive, you know? And so these giant tree people take that stuff and they go, let's stretch that as far as we can get it into fantasy. And they think all the mountains that you're looking at, you stand them up and they used to be giant biblical trees. And part of the reason I found that was in their evidence of why this existed is all that gas that goes way out beyond the moon was once when the trees were way bigger and there was more oxygen in the atmosphere and that sort of thing. And the reason I kind of have to sort of think they might be onto something a little bit is dinosaurs. They couldn't survive on these little spindly trees I've got out here. They'd have to have much bigger stuff. So the trees would have had to have been a lot bigger.
Well, I think they
everything
were.
Was larger.
Yeah. Have you seen the devil's...
And you know what caused that? Super, super concentration of carbon dioxide and oxygen.
Right, yeah, yeah. But they're thinking that these mountains or these trees are just like 2 or 3 miles high or something. I'm thinking probably not. They're thinking it's like Tree of Might, Dragon Ball Z style trees is what they were looking at. But if I learned anything from cartoons, it's that one of them stinking trees would have drained the whole world into a single piece of fruit, so we know that's fiction. Anyway, you ever seen the Devil's Tree Stump out in, I think it's like Iowa or something like that? Mm-hmm. That's the one they always use as the poster child. It literally does look like a giant tree stump.
Okay.
So anyway, that's the capstone for my
It's a mountain that looks like a tree stump?
Yeah, I'll show it to you when we bring it up. It literally does look like a tree stump.
I know what you're talking about.
So that's pretty cool. I always like to learn about new stuff.
Kind of the point how you said with that, some of the other moons and planets that have atmospheres that are a bit weaker than ours, they do actually, you'll see stuff from like in their radiography from film and stuff that they get off of the probes and stuff, that their atmospheres sometimes do leak out further than what the planets
The semantics is what you're calling an atmosphere, and if you say, well, technically atmosphere goes all the way out here, that's going to confuse the whiz out of school children, so you do have to bring it in a little bit and say, well, planes go this high.
Unless we're just telling them all wrong, like the electric universe theory, if you guys are into that.
Velikovsky.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting.
Have you ever looked at the electric universe? That's one of my favorite ones, actually.
Gravity's actually a product of the electric and magnetic interaction.
I haven't directly, but I probably know. It's
1930s, if I'm not mistaken, is a guy named Velikovsky, and he was rivaling Einstein. And his whole idea was that there's, and I can show you a bunch of this stuff when we get done, because you'll be here all night, and they don't have time for this. But essentially, there's so much electricity going through space and stuff that if you can imagine like static clean, that's kind of how everything's circling, is everything is connected by all these invisible electrical currents that are connecting everything together,
which is what caused mass to condense, is what causes gravity, it's what causes it's basically a unified field theory.
Yeah,
of
it gets rid of dark
and
matter and stuff is essentially what it does.
It's pretty interesting. I think he was onto something. It's pretty neat. A lot of stuff like that, you know, I think it's kind of, you just kind of take it with a grain of salt and think it was out there, but
it's interesting.
Yeah,
that's
stuff,
I
think he was onto something, whether his complete theory is right or wrong or whatever, but I think it's pretty neat.
Have you seen, well, one of the ways I found Velikovsky was through the concept of electrical scarring. Mm-hmm. You seen that? Mm-hmm. Where, and I don't believe this because I've seen evidence, like they think that if you look at the Earth from a topographical form, that if you look at all the river patterns and stuff, they do look like giant snake patterns, almost the way electrical scarring would happen. If you look at like a bolt of electricity, if you just kept that pattern going, it doesn't go in like a plasma beam like you would see an Iron Man. It does this weird snaking sort of pattern. And that's exactly, if you get like a view, I've got a picture on my phone of the Mississippi from an airplane, it does that. It looks like a giant serpent going down the United States all the way down. It's wild looking.
Hey, I always heard Paul Bunyan.
Yeah,
so that's what I'm sticking with, and I think that's about enough to.
Could go into Norris.
So anyway, water also. The whole point was water also does that too. If you just watch natural water patterns going down, it snakes. So for whatever reason, so yeah, I'm an idiot.
Well, I think that about wraps it up. But I hope, Dustin, you'll join us again, won't you?
Yeah, hopefully I can be a bit more versed in our
he can be a part of the stupidity.
Well, we called Dustin at the last minute, you know, we were just, we thought, well, we could have Dustin come on and talk about one particular thing, and then we was like, probably just let him
he's kind of got the same mind.
So I think he'd be a good addition to the pod, if not every time, you know, whenever he's able to. I hope we'll have Dustin back, and hope you guys can see him some more. And let's talk about some of these ideas. We'll do a live show eventually once we get enough people walk. I think if we can start getting a couple hundred views, that'll even be enough to even try a live and see who we can get going. Yeah, so
if we can get up to 100 though, I definitely think it would be cool to do some live streaming, just because I would like to see what people think about certain stuff. Because yeah. I know I say a lot of really. When I talk, I literally just start word vomiting, and I know I say some really stupid stuff, so I'd kind of like to either see people bounce some of those dumb things back at me so I can get a laugh out of it,
yeah.
Or at least be checked in real time.
Yeah, yeah.
So my words don't become a virus.
like the Polly, what's that movie? You ever see that movie? Polly, I can't think of it. It's a movie about a virus that's transmitted through people talking.
No, I didn't know about that.
Oh, it's pretty neat.
Oh, crap.
Polly something. I can't think of the name of it. I'll tell you about it we'll look it up after we get down here. But it was super cool. It's like a zombie virus kind of, but mm-hmm. they would get it through the language.
I know exactly what you're talking about, but I can't think of the name of it.
That's interesting.
Yeah, so that's another thing we'll talk about is movies, too, because all of us are movie guys. We're all music guys. It's not all going to be current events and politics. Like I said, we're going to do music. We're going to do entertainment stories. I've got a hilarious dude who knows a lot of entertainment stories. I've got Moose who knows a lot of entertainment stories. There's a lot of cool people in our area who can tell you a lot of very interesting, funny, cool stories. A lot of personalities. There's old folks that live around here that you would not believe some of the stuff they tell you, so maybe we can get some of them on, too.
And I'm going to spend the next couple of years trying to not convince, nay, I say, I will show you that the Thundercats is the history of our world leaders.
Oh, and I'm so ready for that. Since you told me about that, I'm so
ready. Every episode has a conspiracy theory in it, laced in there. And I will show you.
Yeah, but this has been the Iron Mountain Hour. We're signing off now. Come back and check us out. Subscribe to the channel. We'll tell you when we start on the other ones, but look up the first video. You know, if you watch this one, go back and watch the first one about smart poles. We get more into a lot of that, and it's a good talk. It takes about an hour, but with an actual smart pole, that's probably 30 minutes that we talk on that. So check it out. Let us know what you think, and let us know if you think we're ready for Mars. Give us some topics that you think would be interesting.
To Mars.
Yes. but anyway, thanks for joining us tonight. This has been the Iron Mountain Hour, and we'll see you next time.